Chapter 14, Spring Thaw. Gabriel Faulkner had not only ordered new furniture for his planned business event, he had also apparently arranged for what had been stored in the basement to be taken away. By the time that Sierra was at last able to make her way down to the lower level beneath the house, her focus was not on the mystery of what was behind locked doors. Now she was determined to find out what was stored in those boxes. With the curiosity of a child in a toy store, Sierra inspected each carton over the next week, and with the tenacious of a mother guarding her cubs, she allowed only what she deemed beyond reclaiming to be carted away. Furniture and boxes came and discarded items in boxes went. By the end of the week, there was so much furniture and boxes of dishes and linens in the downstairs rooms that Sierra was feeling quite overwhelmed. She called Cornell Allen. "Mrs. Allen," she cried out in panic, "where am I supposed to put all this stuff? Where are the people that are supposed to know what Mr. Faulkner wants done?" she demanded accusingly. "There are 6 beds, 5 sofas, about 20 chairs, plus 3 dining tables. With chairs, dressers, and end tables, lamps, dishes, sheets, drapes, I don't know what all. It's piled everywhere," she lamented, pausing to catch her breath. "How am I supposed to know what to do with this stuff? I told you I couldn't do this," Sierra continued, the despair in her voice almost making her words incoherent. "Oh, my dear girl," Cornell Allen replied in her calm, soothing voice. It ironically had the opposite of calming effect on the distraught woman. "Don't worry," Mrs. Allen continued. "There is a team of professionals coming on Monday," she assured Sierra. "I am glad that you called me to let you know that all the things have been delivered. Did you check the inventory to see that all was there before you signed?" "Yes," Sierra acknowledged, "and I had the beds and chests taken up to vacant rooms, but I chose those rooms at random and..." "Yes, yes," Cornell clucked, cutting off Sierra's explanation. "When the workers come next week, you can let them set it all up as you want it, and then you can direct them to do a thorough cleaning. I believe there is to be a total of 10 persons, both men and women. We have them for a week, but if you see that we need more to get it all done in a week's time, then let me know. It will all sort itself out. You are doing splendidly. Don't worry so much," Mrs. Allen added. "That's easy for you to say. You aren't here in the middle of this mess. And I have no idea what rooms I am supposed to put this stuff in. I just sort of went by instinct," Sierra grumbled. "You underestimate yourself, Sierra," Cornell chided. "Gabriel would not have entrusted you for this task if he didn't have complete confidence in you. I have known him long enough to know that he has an uncanny sense of knowing the right person to give responsibility to. His business ventures are very successful. Trust yourself." "If you say so," Sierra answered doubtfully. "There's a first time for everything, and I think this is more monkey business than anything," she added under her breath. "What did you say, dear?" Cornell asked. "I think our connection is bad." "Nothing," Sierra replied, speaking up. "But just tell Mr. Faulkner that if this is a bust, it's not my fault." "No, on second thought, scratch that. I will let you get back to your work now, Mrs. Allen. Bye." "Call me anytime, Sierra, day or night," Cornell responded cordially. Yes, okay, bye. Goodbye, dear, Mrs. Allen replied. Over the next week, night after night, and weary with fatigue, Sierra fell into bed in dreamless sleep. The formerly empty bedroom took on an attractiveness to rival a fine hotel suite as fresh pillows and coverlets were spread over beautifully designed bed frames. Matching dressers and ornately framed mirrors, lamps and accessories were placed in each room. Many of these accessories were recycled from the items that Sierra salvaged from the basement. In the downstairs rooms, Sierra let her own desire for comfort be the guide as she grouped sitting rooms around dining tables in a more informal, functional arrangement. Then she combined more of the basement finds among the rooms with ornamental pieces in a charming, if not truly traditional, design. 1 week sped quickly into two. Sierra completely forgot all about doors that do not open, noises in the wall, and barking dogs in the middle of the night. Nor did she have time to notice that Granger Vanderholt was now absent from the many busy workers that invaded the house. In addition, as the gloomy rooms came to life, Sierra almost completely forgot that she was not doing this to please her own case, but for a wealthy and extremely powerful man whose sparse and austere taste was that of the master bedroom across from her own. Then, as the lodge was becoming a hospitable place to live, and when Sierra thought that all of her paranoid imaginings were just that, imaginings of the ghosts of the past reappeared, along with a sense of deja vu that accompanies paranormal encounters. Sierra was busy unpacking with the volume of the music from the local station blaring loudly to fill the room with lively energy. She put the utility knife to the taped box, one of many that she had the workers bring up from the basement. She was expecting to find more dishes or glass decorative items, and she was surprised to see they contained photograph albums instead. In an effort to ease her cramped legs, Sierra settled back against another of the boxes and pulled out a black leather-bound book and laid it on the floor. She then leisurely turned several pages of baby pictures and school pictures of children as she enjoyed the nostalgia of the images on the pages. Turning the next page, a shock of resignation sent a sharp, piercing sensation through her chest, and a cold, crawling feeling spread from her neck up, over her scalp, and down her spine. On this page was a beautiful picture of a bride dressed in an exquisite satin and lace dress. Though the face was that of a young woman, the resemblance was unmistakable. Here was the woman who had been in Sierra's dream the first night she was at the lodge. And to her knowledge, she had never met or seen this woman except in that dream. A dream that was still so real that she could remember all the details much later. Sierra studied the picture carefully for any resemblance to the owner of the lodge, and could see none. In fact, the sepia-toned photograph gave the woman a look reminiscent of the film actresses that she watched on the classic movie channel. Jean Harlow and Ginger Rogers came to mind, because the bride appeared to be a blonde woman. An old-fashioned style lace veil was artfully arranged to frame the elegant bone structure of the woman's face. The dress and quality of the photograph looked very expensive. Could this be a picture of Granger Vanderholt's mother or sister? Sierra pondered. But if so, why was it in the cellar of the lodge among the discarded furniture boxes? With that question and others racing for prominence in her head, Sierra flipped back to the preceding pages to review the pictures of the children. And then she looked past the bright photo to the rest of the album's photos. The remaining photographs were old ones with the stiff look of families gathering for a family photo. Unlike the pictures of the children on the first pages, these were almost entirely pictures of older men and women. One handsome man with waved medium-colored hair and dressed in a tweed suit of bygone era was posed with his foot on the running board of a large vintage car. Another elderly couple was standing on a porch surrounded by ferns. After gazing at the pictures for several more moments, Sierra stretched out her body to relieve the stiffness. Then, rising from her position on the floor, she carefully placed the book back in its original resting place. With an illogical feeling that she had been a peeping Tom, intruding into someone's privacy without permission. Exactly whose privacy she was invading was still a mystery. It was impossible to be certain, but these were not the kind of pictures that she found in the attic. With only a cursory inspection, she recognized that they were recently stored assortment of loose, candid shots and greeting cards. These two identical boxes looked more like oversized oblong hat boxes than packing cartons. They contained family memories that definitely should not be discarded. So Sierra decided that she would find the owner. By identifying the family, she would be able to uncover what was now a burning curiosity. What connection did the bride in the photograph have to this house? And why did she see the woman in her strange dream? Furthermore, why were these boxes in the basement with all of the other furnishings that Gabriel Faulkner had consigned to be discarded? While stacking the two boxes into a hall closet, Sierra thought of four possible answers. Most likely was the owner of the lodge himself, and perhaps the former wife, Ravina, nearest neighbor and estate caretaker, was another. Granger was less likely candidate, even if the features of the bride in the portrait had a resemblance to the man. Then, of course, his wife, the absent housekeeper, could have misplaced her family mementos. She was a close friend of the former Mrs. Faulkner. She also had at one time had unlimited access to the lodge. So on a crusade to return the lost treasures, Sierra dressed to do the unthinkable. She would pay a return visit to her unsociable neighbor. She was on a mission, and as she made her way up the gravel road to her destination, her cell phone rang. And this was not a call that was welcome. "Mrs. Allen can wait," she muttered. "I am doing a good deed. This is not just idle curiosity." Enough to melt the snow, the wind sweeping through the open path between the wooded area and the road was not warm enough to be at a standstill. And Sierra arrived at her destination rather quickly, due to her brisk pace. She placed her booted foot on the first stone step of the house of the caretaker of Faulkner Lodge. The structure was built of the same stone as the lodge itself, but there the resemblance ended. This sprawling two-story home was what Sierra would have labeled a true lodge. The dozens of windows overlooking the drive door windows echoed that same design. Sierra peered inquisitively into the interior. Open to her view was a wide hallway that went to the back of the home. On each side of the polished expanse of wood floors were doors that led to adjacent rooms, and the furnishings in the hallway were sparse and plants and ivy. The homey setting seemed quite at variance to the current resident's personality, but a perfect setting for the dogs that lived there, Sierra thought. She took a deep breath to reinforce her resolve and then pushed the doorbell button. Within seconds, the sound of dogs could be heard, followed by the large, lumbering canines themselves. A sharp command that could be heard quite clearly through the heavy door stopped the animals in their tracks. Immediately, they stood at attention like soldiers, each dog with his large head turned expectantly toward the rear of the house. As Granger Vanderholt approached the door, Sierra took a step back. She suddenly had an overwhelming urge to turn and flee, but was stopped mid-thought by the man's loud command. "Yes," he shouted through the door, "what do you want?" "Oh, Lord," Sierra muttered under her breath. "What do I want? To find out who some stuff belongs to. To pry and ask questions that are probably none of my business." "Oh, Lord," she muttered again. "Whatever possessed me to come here and think I could talk to this horrible man?" However, in a loud voice with enough volume to be heard through the window, she announced, "I need to ask you something." "What?" The word sounded more like a threat than a question. Granger had opened the door, and the expression on his face clearly conveyed the message that Sierra was an unwanted visitor. Sierra wavered weakly. "You know that a lot of stuff has come for the conference that Mr. Faulkner is having at the lodge, and he wants all the old furniture that was stored in the basement to be taken away, boxes and stuff," she added. Granger reclined his head in acknowledging Sierra's statement. Unsure of how much more of an explanation was required, Sierra continued, "Well, I came across a couple of boxes that were in the cellar that were photograph albums," she went on bravely, "and I thought you could look at them and see who they belong to." Sierra's voice then died away as the man stared at her in that way she had come to know. The look implied that, number one, you are bothering me with this, or number two, speak English, lady, because I cannot understand a word you say. "Where are they?" he asked, looking around to see if they were in fact visible. And then, to Sierra's astonishment, he added, "Come in, you are shaking with cold. The damp gets into the bone in weather like this. Even if it's above freezing, the wind makes it much colder." Sierra followed the man's back in almost shock, but it was happy shock. The kitchen where she was led to at the rear of the house was warm and inviting. Small windows completely lined the back and side walls of the room in an L shape. The decor resembled kitchens as she remembered from childhood. The appliances were also old, from a bygone era, reinforcing the impression that Sierra had made when viewing the hallway. Antique lovers lived here. To her surprise, everything about the interior of this house felt like a home, and the atmosphere of the kitchen proclaimed that this was a happy place. Sierra felt her hostility of the man who lived here begin to melt. He hospitably motioned her to sit in one of the overstuffed chairs placed before a stone fireplace. She smiled gratefully and settled herself into its soft, well-worn leather depths. "I can start a fire, warm you up," Granger offered. Sierra declined with a motion of her head. Gabe tells me you are partial to sitting in front of the fire. With those words, the man smiled a very friendly smile. The smile warmed his eyes, turning them from ice blue to resemble a clear lake of water on a sunny day. This smiling and relaxed man was extremely attractive and dangerous to a girl's senses, Sierra mused in fascination. For the first time since meeting Granger Vanderholt, Sierra could see why Poppy Clell might have chosen this blonde German Adonis over his dark, phenomenally wealthy best friend. Gabriel Faulkner was the one that had not been chosen for her to marry. Sierra forced her thoughts away from pursuing that intriguing subject and concentrated on the mission at hand. Tea, coffee, whiskey, Granger offered. Tea, Sierra responded, if it's not too much trouble. Not at all, came the response as her host turned his back to put a large black cast iron kettle on the fire. I'm surprised you came to me, he remarked. Why didn't you call Gabe about the boxes? I don't have his phone number, Sierra replied honestly. My instructions were to call Mrs. Allen. You know, the employment agency lady that hired me, she explained. But since you know the family from way back, I thought you were the best person to ask. I think I should be flattered by this visit then, Granger chuckled, still busy arranging cups for the tea. I'm sorry if I intruded, Sierra murmured. Mrs. Allen told me to contact her, and she would see to whatever. Gabe didn't give you his number, Granger persisted, turning to level a questioning blue gaze at his visitor. Here was the return of the man that Sierra was familiar with. He was a chameleon, she decided, and a very good one. She shook her head and burrowed deeper into the chair, drawing her knees up to tuck them under her. You should take off your boots and that coat. You may not believe this, but you will be warmer, Granger commanded. I am warm, Sierra denied. It was not the cold that was making her uncomfortable, for the room was quite warm. Nevertheless, she did remove her coat. And I really can't stay long enough to dry my boots. I just wanted to see if you would identify the photos for me when you had time. And then get out of your hair, she added apologetically. I will be glad to try, but you haven't explained why you don't take this to Gabe. His house? More than likely his pictures. You two were friends, he asked bluntly, his gaze riveted to Sierra's face. She blushed profusely because there was unconcealed amusement in the man's eyes. He knew about the relationship between her and his best friend. It was obvious the two of them had discussed her. The revelation made Sierra angry. Mr. Faulkner told me that the things in the basement were things his former wife ordered, and he didn't want any of them. I didn't want to bother him with this if the photos belonged to her, she explained defensively. I also thought since your wife was a friend to her, I mean, if you said they were hers, she could get them to her. I think they meant something to someone, and I... My wife and Ravina Faulkner are no longer friends, Granger countered. I doubt that the photo belongs to anyone other than Gabe. He has family all over this state. West Virginians are prolific breeders. I understand Germans don't do bad either, Sierra shot back without thought. I presume that remark was aimed at me and my numerous siblings, Granger remarked without rancor. Though she lives in Germany, my mother stoutly insists she is Russian. Catholics believe in large families. Now, my father is from the Netherlands. From one of those mixed-breed families that the war produced in the past century. Okay, Sierra conceded, but how do you know that the pictures are not Mrs. Faulkner? Ravina and Poppy, my wife, had similar backgrounds. They were roommates, if you want to be technically correct. I'm not sure either woman would say they were friends. More like friendly combatants, he added. Neither had close relatives, he went on. Poppy was raised in an orphanage. Her mother died from TB. Ravina came from some impoverished backwoods family in Little Rock, Arkansas, if I remember correctly. According to her, she was passed around before she ran to the city to be a singer. Do any of the photographs look like that kind of people? No, Sierra admitted. There is a professionally done portrait of a bride that looks something like Greta Garbo. In fact, I thought it might be your mother. Don't let my looks deceive you, lady, Granger laughed heartily. My mother looks like a dark rom. I don't know who the pictures belong to, but they are not mine. I can't for the life of me understand why you haven't dumped all this speculative curiosity of yours in old Gabe's lap. You two have a fight, or are you on a fishing expedition? The man's question hit a raw nerve. He had accurately assessed her motive, and his laughter caused Sierra to explode with indignation. I'm glad to be entertainment for you and your pal, Mr. Faulkner, but I mean only to live up to my responsibilities, and I thought I was doing something good here today. I don't have Mr. Faulkner's phone number. He obviously does not think I need it. But now I will let you get back to your own work, she ended with dignity and rose to her feet. Not without tea, Granger argued accommodatingly. Sit down or come here to the table and sit down. I made you tea, and I'm not going to let your temper make me ill-mannered and allow you to leave without having a cup. So sit down, he ordered again. Sierra sat down. It was at that moment that the phone in her coat pocket vibrated again. The two dogs snoozing as if sleeping lions guarding the door simultaneously raised their massive heads, their noses sniffing the air expectantly. Are you going to answer that? Granger asked from his perch in front of the cooking range. Yes, Sierra answered, more out of a chance at a distraction than a desire to answer a telephone call. Hello, she called out cheerfully into the mouthpiece. Miss Coulson, my dear girl, how are you? Cornell Allen's voice spoke over the wire. I left an earlier message. Did you get it? No, Sierra admitted. I am away from the house, and I haven't had time to check my messages. What did I miss? No, not anything immediate, but Mr. Faulkner wanted me to particularly ask you to expect him this weekend, Mrs. Allen said. Sierra eyed the estate handyman slash manager, who was nonchalantly leaning against the oven door as if he was unconcerned about their conversation. But she was not deceived by his overdramatic attempt to be unobtrusive. Mrs. Allen, she said, lowering her voice, why the notice? After all, I'm only the employee. And when exactly on the weekend? What day, I mean? I think he means to inspect all your handiwork, my dear, Cornell replied. And I expect he wanted to give you notice. But I am only a messenger, not a psychic. Oh, Lord, Sierra muttered. If things are not ready, Gabriel will send out more workers to help you. That is more likely to be his intent. You are not to worry. I am sure you have done splendidly, Mrs. Allen assured her. Are you telling me that to feel better or for yourself? Sierra retorted glumly. You are not at home, you say, Cornell changed the subject artfully. Where are you? In town? No, Sierra answered, moving her head to the face sideways from the man who was not hiding the fact that he was listening. I'm having tea with Mr. Vanderholt at his house. The statement must have had the effect of rendering the employment manager speechless, for the line went almost dead. Mr. Vander Cornell asked in a dubious tone. Yes, Sierra affirmed, smiling at the reaction. He is right here. Do you want to speak to him? Whatever are you doing there, Cornell? Inquired, ignoring Sierra's question. Did he invite you to come over? My dear girl, you must not be so trusting. No, no, Mrs. Allen, it is nothing like that, I assure you. And his two big guard dogs are protecting him as we speak, so we are well chaperoned, Sierra explained rather defensively. You are making light of this, my dear girl, but I am older and I have more experience. This man is not one of us. He has a questionable past, and he tends to get what he wants. All the Faulkner brides have been caught regrettably in his web. Just be warned by me and be careful around this man. Mrs. Allen, you can't tell me things like this and then not give me a full explanation. That is not fair, Sierra protested, giving Granger a dark, you monster look. He had the audacity to wink at her as if he could hear the conversation. I am not one to air dirty linen by gossiping, but I must tell you that the man you are having tea with is responsible for the collapse of your employer's previous marriage, Cornell informed Sierra. You say gossip. Is this truth or hearsay? Sierra questioned bluntly. Unfortunately, it is true. More's the pity, Cornell answered. I will be advised by your words, Sierra replied. I think I have overstayed my welcome anyway, so I will hang up now. Good for you, Cornell responded encouragingly. By the way, she added, I will be in St. Thomas for the next few days with my family. Leave your message on the voicemail and I will get back as quickly as possible. You deserve a holiday. Good for you, Sierra said. You have a good time. I will be fine, so don't even think of me while you are soaking up all that wonderful sun. Bye now. Sierra clicked the cell phone shut and picked up her cup of tea she had placed on the ledge of the fireplace. Without regard to the lukewarm condition of the brew, she emptied it in one gulp. Thank you for the hospitality and the tea, she said to her host with great formality. I will be going now. That headhunter warned you off, didn't she? Granger remarked, eyes back into his eyes, as well as in his tone. What? She sputtered. Off what? She told you about that witch coming between me and Gabe, he replied angrily. Is it true? Sierra inquired bluntly. That depends on what she said, he answered. I've heard so many versions of the tale, I'm not sure what's truth and what's fiction anymore. That woman damn near cost me my marriage and a man I love more than a brother by her sick gains. Without another word, Granger Vanderholt escorted Sierra to the front door with his ever-present dogs following in procession. At the front entry doorway, the man addressed his guest in an unexpected mood of gallantry. Can I drive you back to the lodge? He inquired. No, the sun is still out and I would enjoy the walk, Sierra declined. Suit yourself, he muttered sourly. The charming manners had quickly vanished. As Sierra walked briskly toward the lodge, she wondered if the charming, charismatic man that she witnessed briefly was a hologram.